So first, thanks to all those who were part of the Pride Parade yesterday. Thanks to Ellie for organizing it for me. We had a great time. We had two things. Well, first of all, we had with flags tied around us. We were just geared up to begin with. But we had bubbles and we had stickers. And if you want to make a crowd happy, who's already happy, we had these bubble shooter things and stickers of flags to hand out to everybody. And it was just a great time. We could tell people we're glad to be together. It just gets, it's so interesting. We kept talking about how many years ago when we thought that this could happen, all of this, how many years ago. And just seeing people in all together in a crowd, comfortable, out in public being who they are, and other people celebrating that. It just is so good to see after, not only after so many years, all this time, it makes it difficult, but knowing also what we have in front of us. There's still a lot of, there were a lot of chirps and things about supporting trans kids because they're the target right now, but also concerned about, the future. So we've got a long road on this, but so glad that we have been able to celebrate and to keep remembering to do that celebration. So glad to be a part of that. We were in the church crowd. Oh, there were a bunch of churches, which was great. And I thought it would be great. Right behind us was the organization that was for the separation of church and state. And I thought that is the perfect one to be bringing up the rear mirror. So yeah, we had a good time. Just congrats to John on his retirement, John Marconis. So. Every day, both me and Allie, though, it's funny to be at a parade with them and, hear them all. Allie's running from side to side, hugging every kid and teenager and whatever. And Jaws has kept hearing, that's Mr. Rapkunis, but again, what a great statement to have kids go, hey, that's my teacher. And they're marching in this parade. That's so great. So even though they are your kids, but they're not your kids anymore. But my congratulations. And thank you, Camille. I see Camille Rose on our call for volunteering to be our church treasurer. I don't know if I got picked up on the microphones, but thank you so much for doing that. Christine Southern has just been hanging in there with us and just going, okay. But Camille has been willing to take over. And this is a particularly, welcome to the thick of it, Camille. We are also switching bookkeepers. This week, Stacey Savlin has resigned, but we also had lined up a new service that's a professional service with them. So we started that transfer on Tuesday, and they will officially be transferred July the 1st. So in between time, we're just going to make it all happen. So you'll still will remain the same where you send anything. If you have any questions, to finance@firstparishforum.org. For these next couple of weeks, why don't you just call me or call the office if you have a question, because I don't know how much that email is going to get looked up until July 1st. So we will do this. We are also now looking for a new office manager. Leslie told me that she'd like to be done as of July 21st. So we have a job opening. I know a lot of changes in the summer. We have a job opening now for 16 hours a week. I say it's school hours. It can all be Monday through Thursday from 9 to 1 or something like that. So if you know anybody that's looking for a part-time job, we have lots of flexibility. I come with them. We have 8, 9 big holidays. I'm like, wow. But you come with all the big federal holidays, and that's what it comes to. And, we throw Christmas in there too. So let me know if you know of anybody or send them my way. If they'd like to be a part of that. Any other announcements that we have today?
Just a reminder that the mission project for this month is the kitchen group 2. But they're the ones in Ukraine that are feeding so many people. So that's where a lot of our work is going towards for this month.
Okay, so check the glass if you need more information on that. I think there's a little bit less. So, all right. This morning, this being Juneteenth, please read General Orders Number 3. And I'm a lot of times I notice that the first part of it gets read, but not the second part. And particularly as people are looking around, I think all of us identify as white. If we have to check a box, it would be white on anything. We need to hear the second part as much as we need. So this is from Galveston, Texas, on June 19, 1865, General Orders Number 3. The people of Texas are informed that in accordance with the proclamation from the Executive of the United States, yes, that's what they call them, all slaves are free. This involves an absolute equality of personal rights and rights of property between former masters and slaves, and the connection heretofore existing between them that becomes that between employer and hired labor. The freed men are advised to remain quietly at their present homes and work for wages. They are informed that they will not be allowed to collect at military posts and that they will not be supported in idleness either there or elsewhere. By order of Major General Green. This is what we remember today, that this is when the last people heard that they are equal and free. And that even in this statement, it was qualified and it still is to this day. Let's work so that we can truly be a place where all are free. Let us worship together. Wherever you are, whoever you are, whatever you come with, wherever you are going, you are seen, you are heard, you are welcome, you have always belonged. For thousands of years, indigenous people have walked on this land on their own land. The relationship with the land is at the center of their lives. We acknowledge these lands upon which we worship as the ancestral, cultural, traditional, and unceded lands of the Wabanaki Confederacy of the Endocrine people. We commit ourselves to the work of dismantling the ongoing legacies of settler colonialism. Let's stand together and sing our first hymn with every voice and sing as we celebrate its anniversary this year. Today is right.
We have Let us pray. Loving God, as we sing these words, we know that for most of us, they were not written for us, that they were written for a people who we made outsiders. And today, still, our structures that we support do the same. God, as we join our voices with theirs, as we sing this song, let it change our hearts. Let us open our minds. Let this song and your love set us out on the work so that we are indeed all your people together in all that we do. All this we ask in your name. Amen. If you're standing, you may be seated. And for our centering prayer today in this Juneteenth day, and also for us, as we think about that word freedom, we talk about that word also as people of faith, not just a freedom that we have as people in a country, but the freedom that we have to be God's people in this world together. And the freedom that we have to choose to be in God's work or to not be a part of God's work. And we hear from different voices in different places in different ways so that we can learn in new ways what we need to see and who we need to be. So as we offer this poem called Freedom by Langston Hughes, an amazing poet, let us open our hearts and our lives to God's freedom. So if you would, ground yourself with your feet with whatever ground you are on and with your seat in your seat and find your breathing. That thing indeed we all do together. Take in and return to. Freedom will not come today, this year, nor ever through compromise and fear. I have as much right as the other fellow has to stand on my two feet and own the land. I tire so of hearing people say, "Let things take their course. Tomorrow's another day." I do not need my freedom when I'm dead. I cannot live on tomorrow's bread. Freedom is a strong seed planted in a great need. I live here too. I want my freedom just as you. Loving God, what are the voices that we silence? Which are the voices that we refuse to hear? Loving God, forgive us for doing that. And let us show our want of forgiveness by changing what we say, what we do, how we live. God, for all freedom comes from you, and you do not give it to some and not to others. Let us live as you do. All this we ask in your name. Amen.
Let my prayer rise up like incense before you, the lifting up of my hands as an offering to you. Let my prayer rise up like incense before you, the lifting up of my hands as an offering to you.
I see trees of green, red roses too. I see them bloom for me and you. And I think to myself, what a wonderful world. Blessed day, the dark sacred night, and I think to myself, what a wonderful world. The colors of the rainbow, so pretty in the sky, are also of people passing by. I see friends shaking hands, saying, how do you do? They're really saying, I love you. I hear babies cry. I watch them grow. They'll learn much more than I'll ever know. And I think to myself, what a wonderful world. Yes, I think to myself, what a wonderful.
Can I have the children come forward, please? We have a few. Jacob, come on up. We've got Amy and Jill. Come on up. Right here. How does that sound? Between the amp and the guitar. Are you coming, Amy? Nice sparkles. Wow, pretty snazzy. Are you five yet, Amy? No, not quite. Four and a half, yeah.
Six.
And you're six, wow, okay. So you guys are close to each other, right? Two, though she's four and a half. You ask her, right, Amy? Right, yeah, definitely. Hey, you guys, we have a story today about Jesus needing to learn. Now, do you think about, when you think about the stories of Jesus, do you think about him needing to learn? Usually we talk about Jesus as our teacher, right? He was teaching the disciples. Even when he was like 12 years old, he was teaching people, like he was doing all this teaching. But he was somewhere and a woman asked, her daughter was very sick. And the woman said, can you heal my daughter? And he said, I don't know if I'm supposed to be talking to people like you. Yeah. Can you imagine Jesus saying something like that? I know, right? We forget that he did do that. And do you know what the woman did? She said, you know what? I think you should talk to me. And I think you're here to talk to everybody. And she said it in a very nice way. And do you know what he said? He said, yep, you're right. And your daughter's healed. But I think Jesus learned a really important lesson that day, is that you can't just be a teacher. You have to be a student too. Are you guys students? Not right now, are you? You're a student, but school's done, right? For the for this year. Oh, almost? You have to go back to school yet? Tomorrow's your last day? Was your last day? Oh, so you are done. And yeah. And Amy, are you done too?
Yeah.
Yes, because you were in preschool, weren't you? Yeah. Yeah. First grade. Wow. And you're going to be in the fall. Will you be in kindergarten? Kindergarten? Not yet. Not yet. Okay. Getting close. Yeah. Yep. But have you, okay. So I have another question. Did you ever teach anybody anything? You didn't teach. You've never taught anybody anything? Okay, you taught, do you remember what you've taught people?
No.
No? No. Do sometimes you help your grandparents with their computer?
No.
No, you don't have, oh, really? I would have thought they would ask you to do something. Have you taught your little brother how to do something?
Yeah.
Yes, that's a big one. So we have two teachers sitting right here, a retired one and a teacher there, Allie and John, right? The Rimkunises. I'm gonna ask, their teachers, they get paid to teach, right? So they're the ones in your classrooms and stuff. Do your kids ever teach you something in your classroom? All the time. Look at that. So they're standing up there getting paid to teach and they get to learn at the same time. And we have to remember that we do both things. Even you guys at six and four and a half teach us things. Sometimes you teach us how to be really kind when we're not being so kind, right? Or maybe you teach us how to use our phone when we can't figure it out, you know, stuff like that, all right? That's a good thing to teach, isn't it? Yeah. But we have to remember that God wants us to both learn. There's a lot we have to learn, isn't there? Even when you're a person my age, who a lot we have to learn, but that God also uses us to teach love in this world. Do you think you can find two things this week? One is to learn something new about how to love somebody. And do you think you can teach somebody about how to be kind and loving? You think you can do those two things this week? Oh, I think you can. All right, let's pray. I think you can. Let's pray. Loving God, we aren't just students and having to learn. You also want us to teach love too. And as we're learning to love, let us also, in all that we do, show other people how to love too. All this we ask in your name. Amen. All right, you want to head with this about? Head out. Go, 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 go. There's lots to do.
Hold my hand while I run this race.
Our scripture lesson today, our story is a story I just told the kids in a different version. They get an abbreviated, cleaned up version sometimes. I didn't want to read to these kids. I was sent only to the lost sheep of Israel, and it's not fair to take the children's food and throw it to the dogs. We have a lot of racist stuff in the this story today, but we can hear it because we are the ones that have to work on making this world different for the children that we have here and for everyone. So let's listen for God's word to us today. Jesus left that place and went away to the district of Tyre and Sidon. Just then, a Canaanite woman from that region came out and started shouting, "Have mercy on me, Lord, Son of David. My daughter is tormented by a demon." But he didn't answer her at all. And his disciples came and urged him, "Would you get rid of her? Send her away, for she keeps shouting after us." And Jesus answered, "I was sent only to the lost sheep of the house of Israel." But she came and knelt before him, saying, "Lord, help me." And he answered, "It's not fair to take the children's food and throw it to the dogs." And she said, "Yes, Lord, even the dogs eat the crumbs that fall from their master's table." Then Jesus answered her, "Woman, great is your faith. Let it be done for you as you wish." And her daughter was healed instantly. May God bless these words to our living. Guess who didn't silence their phone? So we're in summer now. I'm officially calling it summer. I know we're not quite to solstice yet, but we did Pentecost a week late and everything. And I got thinking about, like, what am I going to do for the summer and what series? I've been so busy. Usually I plan these a little further out, but I'm like, no time to think about this. So the first thing that came to my head, I'll let you inside my head, which is a scary place to be, just to warn you. I thought, well, we should talk about the issues. What are the issues of life right now that we have to deal with? And my first response after that was, oh, golly, I just don't have the energy for that. You know, like, no, no, no. And I thought, no, I'd rather just do nothing. Like, I don't want to address this stuff. I'm tired. You know, it's been a hard couple of years with COVID and everything else. And oh, everything. And then I thought, well, how about the healing stories of Jesus? That would be something. A couple summers ago, I did all the kingdom of God is like, you know? And I thought, there's got to be enough stories out there to get us through the summer, right? And then I realized as I'm thumbing through and came up with like 27 of them or something. And unfortunately, we do not have 27 weeks of summer. I'm sorry. I wish we did sometimes, but we do not. I started looking through some of these healing stories and remembering them. And I thought, oh my goodness, these stories, these healing stories, are about the issues of the day. And so I said, well, let's do the healing stories and see if in looking at healing and being in the presence of healing, we can be healed ourselves and have some space for this. Now, I want to tell you why healing stories are difficult to do. It's because for some reason, people expect what is in that story to literally happen to them. I've had people come to me as a minister over the years and say, this happened in this story. Jesus did this. And I'm told if I just pray, it should happen. Why is it not happening for me? And it's very difficult as a minister to refigure their theology in, you know, 20 minutes to an hour in your office. Because I don't think these healing stories are just there A, so that we can be amazed at Jesus. A lot of them are there just for that. That's what they're intended for, was to say, isn't Jesus amazing? The holiness that God, that Jesus is God present with us, that this proves it. And therefore, if we're with Jesus, then we should have proof of that too. And I think that is a bad setup for us, and a bad use of stories too. And I don't know how the promise, you know, this, that these stories became the promise that Jesus would still do this for us. But I do believe that these stories point us to healing. The healing that we can do, the healing that happens to us, the healing that's around us, but not about a supernatural healing that can happen, as even it says in this story today, instantly. That we have to go beyond just the basics in these stories and ask good questions. They're always about good questions. I was listening to what was supposed to be a comedy podcast yesterday or this early this morning or something. And it was with Michael Lewis, who I really enjoy his storytelling. You know, he did Liar's Poker, The Blind Side. I keep forgetting he did that with The Blind Side, wrote that book. He wrote the one about baseball, about the Oakland A's, how they did baseball all the different ways. Moneyball, right? Is it sounded familiar now? You guys know Michael Lewis? Read his stuff. Go home and read his stuff. It's good. He's a good storyteller. But I was listening to him today talk about story and the role of story. And how he said something. He lost his 19-year-old daughter in a car crash a couple of years ago. And he said, the problem when you have a loss like that is you have to completely rewrite the story you were banking your life on. And I just went, wow. That's the most honest like assessment of a sudden loss like that and what we do in our lives. And we do that with any loss. And he says, any loss is really like that, but it's even more profound, you know, when you lose, especially a young person, but a beloved, no matter what age. But I think that's an interesting way to look at stories, to rewrite our stories. And we really have that job every single day. As we look at these stories that we have in our Bible, is how do they need to be rewritten? How have we banked on things in a certain way? And when they don't work, we just kind of throw up our hands instead of doing that really hard work of saying, now, how do I need to retell this story? Maybe I didn't want to retell it. Maybe I wanted a life that was banked on this, that was foundational to that. But that we can find meaning where we are with what's in front of us in a new way if we approach that. So I want to say that these healing stories are about healing, but that we have to ask good questions about that. That's the other thing I heard Michael Lewis say. I'd never heard this before. When he wrote Moneyball, when he wasn't even thinking about that. He said he lived overseas and he came back to the United States, turned on his television and the baseball was on and he was watching baseball. And he, you know, was thinking about some things and looking some of the people up and realized the right fielder was making $6 million a year and the left fielder was making $150,000 a year. And his question for that baseball game was, how are they getting along? They're doing the same job in a slightly different part of the field, but really right field and left field, right? And how can there be such a discrepancy in these two players and what they're making? And how are they part of a team? And that led to the book Moneyball, the movie Moneyball, and really us, if you read it, seeing things, really asking the question, how are people valued? Which is an incredible question. So it's often about the questions we ask. And the question that we've asked about these healing stories, and particularly this one today, especially because you want to gloss over the bad language and Jesus not getting it, is that you're like, oh, well, this is just, look, the daughter gets healed at the end, everything's okay. And we need more than that in here. So today, there is a lot in this story, folks. I mean, all these little stories, I still think like a masterclass of packing everything in to a story. But again, the people hearing them the first time around and who they were told, even as they got written down, would have understood some of this background. We don't understand it. We've made it sometimes easy for ourselves and we miss so much. First, it starts out with a Canaanite woman, right? Canaan is the promised land. Do you remember that? We hear about it in the Old Testament. That's where the Hebrew people were going. They were going to Cana, to the promised land. It is the most mentioned ethnic term in the Bible. And often when we hear it, especially in the Hebrew scriptures, what we hear is those people were supposed to be terminated, exterminated, as the Israelites came into that land of Canaan. So not a particularly good relationship there, if you know what I mean, right? The truth is, those two cultures, the Israelite culture and the Canaan culture, it's said they overlapped and the Israelites derived their culture from the Canaanite culture. The Canaanite culture is probably one of the oldest civilized cultures in the world. So Israelite culture is Canaanite culture. So all this trash talking that goes back and forth between these two groups are really among relatives, right? They've intermarried, they've done all this, they've borrowed culture, all this. The Israelites have actually appropriated culture. That's a big word, cultural appropriation right now. And so them looking down at the Canaanites is really kind of interesting, because that the land that was Canaan is what is now currently today Israel, the Palestine territory, Palestinian territories, parts of Syria, Lebanon, and southern Turkey. They're related. Now, the Israelites are newer. They may have different gods, you know, things like that. But why is it always the question who's on top? It's a land fight. It's a power fight. That's what it is. But during Jesus' time, both of those ethnic groups that identified were both under Roman occupancy. They should have both been fighting the same thing, the Roman Empire, but they keep up their feud. When you have to mention that it's a Canaanite woman, you know that you're talking to people about all the baggage. It's a dog whistle. And literally, then she talks about dogs, right? It's that. People are supposed to go, oh, a Canaanite. What's she doing with a Jewish guy? How dare she come and ask for something for a Jewish guy? So all of this background, and the Hatfields and the McCoys, right? You know, kind of thing. The North and the South, right? All of that comes up here. That's what's here. So she's a woman, first of all. That's strike one. What's she doing coming? Didn't she have anybody that she could send, a male? But she's coming to Jesus. She's a Canaanite. She should have just gone home and never showed up. And then she's hollering. Did you hear? She's shouting. She's yelling out to Jesus. You know who shouts out in the Bible, in these stories of Jesus? A blind man, blind Bartimaeus. I love, he's my favorite. He hollers out to Jesus, Son of David, have mercy on me. They all kind of say the same thing. When nobody's listening, they are just going to holler and raise ruckus, right? The man who's possessed by the legion of demons, he hollers out too. Think about what company she's in. Not great company, you know? And her daughter's got a demon. Remember, she's in the demon class here, right? Even the blind man, you know, it says about Bartimaeus and the other blind people, especially when it says they've been blind since birth. Oh, then you know their parents must have done something wrong. That's what the going idea was about blindness. If you have a baby born blind, the parents are bad. And now this child is like the symbol of their badness. So she is in this outsider of outsider group. All she's got is her loud voice, you think. That's how she's getting attention. Well, that's all we think she has. until the story moves along. And when she hollers, she even uses the right words. Lord, Son of David. Wow. Calling him Lord. She's not supposed to do that as a Canaanite woman. Like, you know, stay apart. You're nothing, you know? That's what she would say. And Son of David, she's acknowledging that most important. She's actually being more radical than other people around her. She's saying, you're in the line of a king, when he's obviously, you know, a peasant kind of teacher that doesn't dress very well and will touch anybody, you know? She knows. And she asks for mercy. Mercy. She's put herself in a position of wanting mercy, when the thing that she's been taught to do as a Canaanite person is not ask for anything from the Israelites, right? Never be vulnerable with them. And what does Jesus do? He tries to ignore her, right? He doesn't answer. He doesn't acknowledge her presence. She is hollering, and he does nothing. And then finally, his disciples come to him and say, you know what? Would you get rid of her? Would you send the bouncer after her, or shame her, or do something, right? There's so many ways to get rid of her. She's a woman. You could just say, get out of here, woman. What are you doing here? You have no standing here, right? She's a Canaanite, like, and he does that, right? Finally, he says, well, I've only come for the lost sheep of Israel. Oh my goodness. Really? Who taught you that? Did your mother? Did your father? Did your culture? Did your teachers in the synagogue? Who taught you that? Your friends? I don't know. But she comes, even after he said that, and she kneels and says, Lord, help me. Now she's put herself in a physical vulnerable position. If she kneels, she could be harmed so quickly by him. She's put herself at his feet. You know, we say, oh, it's such a gracious kind of subservient position. You can get kicked. He could have easily just kicked her aside. And nobody probably would have said anything. She was hollering. She's a woman. She's a Canaanite woman. Like, who cares? And then he says something about, well, okay, you're here. Now you're here. But, you know, the children's food isn't thrown to the dogs. He calls her a dog. And these are not our, you know, well-vaccinated, the cushiest thing in those new, like, anti-anxiety vests and blankets that we buy for our dogs kind of dog, right? Dogs are in and out on the street, coming in. They get kicked all the time. Out of here, we're eating, right? It's only lately that dogs have had this, you know, they say that in the 50s, dogs slept outside. And nobody thought that cruel. Now people, you know, you get called if your dog sleeps outside every night, right? If you chain your dog outside or something like that. But that's what they were. They were like rodents almost, right? And she answers, yes, Lord. She agrees with him. Yet even the dogs eat the crumbs that fall from their master's table. As if he hasn't put her low enough, she says, yes, but I'll even do this. And then I think they got the rest of the story wrong. I knew I wasn't going to be able to get through this. The way they tell it often, and the way I've always heard this is, oh, this was a test of this woman's faith. That's what Jesus was doing with these words. And I knew that never sat well for me. I don't think it was a test. I think they just were embarrassed, and so they didn't write what really happened in this story. I think what really happened, if this story happened, you know, and I think it did, it gets told a couple of times, is that Jesus kneels down and he says, "Teach me how to have your faith. Your faith is healing me." The story goes on, of course, not that way, but says, "Woman, you have great faith. Whatever you want is done." And it says her daughter was instantly healed. I do think that even that is code for Jesus going, "Oh my goodness, I have so much to learn. And I needed to learn from you, Canaanite woman, who I wanted to ignore, who made the crowd uncomfortable and the disciples uncomfortable, who spoke truth even though we didn't want to hear it, who I made keep having her lower herself to me, who knew me better than I knew me. And here I get to learn." Our story for today in this nation is the story of Juneteenth, of that general order number 3 that I think, did anybody learn about this in school when we went to school? No. I didn't know that. I was taught that, oh yeah, after the Emancipation Proclamation, yeah, the war went on for a little while, but the word got around and all the slaves were free. That's not what happened at all. 2 years. This was even a couple of months after, in April, Lee surrendered, and this didn't happen until June. Until the Union Army could actually make their way to Galveston or to Texas and enforce this. So this last phrase, "Freedmen are advised to remain quietly at their present homes and work for wages." Really? How are you free if they're telling you what to do? Telling them who to be. You have to be quiet now. You have to work for wages. Did you notice when they said employer and hired labor? And be quiet. Isn't that just what the disciples told Jesus to do to the woman? Quiet her. Tell her to be quiet. There's no freedom in this. Homes, they were shacks at best. Jobs, really? Were they going to share in the profits? Could they bargain for their wages? I don't think so. This healing story is not about a little girl and a demon. It's about the demon of racism that infected Jesus and the culture around him, that infects us and the culture around us. And what I see in this story, if we tell it the way that it needs to be told, if we don't rely on the way that it's always been told, but break it open, lose our old ideas of it and rewrite anew, we realize that we need healing, like Jesus needed healing. But that woman came that day thinking it was her daughter who was so sick. No, it was Jesus. And Jesus and his disciples were not admitting their woundedness. And she invites him into woundedness. Because whoever does not admit their woundedness will not only never heal, they can never be a healer. In racism, the lie that is propagated is that people have different value. That was the fight with the Canaanites. The Jews wanted to be more important than the Canaaniteness of their lives. One God was better than the way that the Canaanites worshiped. There was a real right and wrong there. We are wounded in such a structure that the structure of white supremacy is that the lie of white supremacy is that we are not one. We are just like Jesus and the Canaanite woman, so related and so part of one another and one another's culture and who we are. And yet we refuse to see that. And in this story, we see how easy it is to ignore. Just try to ignore anybody hollering out. Just have multiple reasons why we don't even have to do it. Even say things like, well, I have another job to do. I've come for this, not for this. Or as Langston Hughes says, you know, in good time, right? It'll all be okay. Where are we hearing the invitation to woundedness and ignoring it? Where are we being invited by people hollering out? We need to hear others. We need to admit that we embody those horrible assumptions. We have to hear how we are all lowered and where we need to work. And so doing that work so that nobody has to use an analogy of dogs ever again. We want to be healers. We talk about that as people of faith, don't we? We are here to heal this world with God's love. But if we really come to terms with our woundedness, do we see ourselves as Jesus in this story? Do we see ourselves as how easy it is and how right it sounds? You know, look at the story we've told around this story, that this proves that he's one with God. How do we need to retell this story? And how do we need to retell our own story? And in that, find our woundedness, embrace it, and in that, find our healing. So much for I'm going to try to do something light this summer, huh? And yet, this is our job. Yesterday, I saw that even more being at the Pride Parade. All the people who were who they were and said, I belong here as much as anybody else. And my job was to check myself every time I saw something that didn't square with the story that I was told since before I was born, right? That the culture is set up to strengthen and reinforce at all times. And I had to say, I need to learn. Not to say to a person, oh, please teach me. No. But I need to learn. To find a way to kneel, just as all the other ones are kneeling. To join them in that place. And only when we all are, can we truly find the strength to stand together. Let's pray. Loving God, heal us of our assumption that these stories that we have are supposed to make us feel good. Show us again these stories and our place in them. Show us that woundedness is even what Jesus was called to. So that indeed, we can be wounded healers. God, teach us in whatever way we can hear and keep hollering to us so that we may be your people of love. All this we ask in your name. Amen. Let's stand together and sing our hymn. The words are in your bulletin, God of Freedom. Be seated. A few of us yesterday, also when we were waiting for the bus to go back home, had the joy of meeting the two people who rented our space last weekend for their baby shower, one of who lives at Courage House and his fiance. And they said, they came up in the girlfriend is, she's the bold one. She's great. She's like, you're Christine, aren't you? I thought, oh, me and my big mouth, what did I say? But they were just so thankful that this could be a warm and welcoming place to them. And it was good to see them. Knowing that they've got not quite a month before that baby comes, and have got a lot to do and a lot that are going on in each of their lives. But again, as I talked about it last week, but again this week too, but just sharing in their joy and being open and hearing them when they ask, just an amazing thing. So let us gather our gifts together as we are a place that works on being open, knowing we still have lots of work to do, but that we can, when we hear, we respond. Let us give our offerings together. We can give all that we don't know we can give yet, all that we don't think we can give because we are not enough. Gracious God, know that you are working in the midst of us, within us, through us, between us, and with us to bring that healing so that we may be your people of love now and always. Take our gifts and our lives for this your world. All this we ask in your name. Amen. If you're standing, you may be seated. And I have before us to use together this prayer by Reverend Dr. William Barber. I don't know if you've seen him on TV or seen his writings. He is one of the founders of the Poor People's Campaign, again, that is happening right now. And he is continually crying out and getting arrested for justice. And just amazing words that we can use today. Let us pray together. Almighty God, we praise your name, for you alone are God. There is none like you, gracious and compassionate, slow to anger, full of love, truth, and justice.
You care for the orphans and widows and look upon the immigrant with affection. Your love is not threatened by the ways we diminish, marginalize, and destroy each other. There is no one like you.
You have made your faithfulness known from generation to generation, and you declare it is better to do justice than to make sacrifice.
We remember how you have, in all of these things, made known your generous love for the least of these. Through the Holy Spirit, you continue to tear down the dividing walls of hostility and inequality that separate us from each other and distort your gospel.
We add our voices to the generations that have gone before us in giving thanks for the freedom you brought to the United States when legal slavery ended. Over 200 years of European-American shipping and trading African peoples as if they were disposable goods distorted our experience of your image, both in those enslaved and in those who enslaved others.
Yet you have a history of overcoming our most dehumanizing abuses of each other. Even when we normalize our abuses through words of law and government-sanctioned violence, thank you for raising up faithful servants who declare and fight for abolition of justice.
Remind us that we must remember and can never retreat. While we have made slavery illegal, too much of society continues to participate in systems, structures, and cultural patterns that diminish, distort, and destroy the lives of persons of color. Too many are still enslaved to racism, to the goals of voter separation, to efforts to block living wages and healthcare. By your spirit, set us free.
Use our remembrance to cause us to never retreat from working to see this nation and worlds released from the deceptive corruption that is in the hearts and patterns and practices that continue to be passed along from generation to generation.
in remembering the day in which the slaves in Texas finally heard their emancipation. We still cry out to you and are open to be used by you to end all slavery, racism, voter suppression, greed, hate, violence, poverty, denial of healthcare, environmental injustice, war, and the false religion of white supremacy and white nationalism.
Lord, when we get tired, free us from apathy and inaction. Open our eyes. Search us, O Lord, and call us into action to bring an end to the injustices that are contrary to your way.
May you make us into one people. Grant us the strength in your name to spend ourselves on behalf of those who are still entangled in slavery, so that together we might experience the full reconciliation and new life that you desire for all people.
We offer this prayer that your glory and honor might be made known through the freedom of all people.
And loving God, as we pray and say these powerful words, may they not just be words. May they come to life in all that we do. May we not turn away from the injustice that we see. May we not count our power as small and too little. But may we remember that we have the power of your love, and in that we can make great healing. God, for those who speak truth, to power, who put their lives on the line to do that, God, we are thankful. Call us to use our very life to be your truth in action. Loving God, on this day, we are also thankful so much for the role that fathers have played in our lives. We think of all of those who have been fathers to us, whether by birth or by choice. And we think of the new ways that fatherhood is being defined among us. And God, we are so thankful for the breaking open and the new questions and the new ways. God, for the opportunities that those among us, that those of us, have the chance to be fathers and to father others in your love. God, let us step forward and do just that. Loving God, for the ways that you ask us to step forward as your people here together, let us not turn from the cries of others, but step forward. Let us not be afraid of our own woundedness, but speak and act in your love. God, we think of those whom we love today, those who are seeking healing of mind and body and spirit. We pray that you be with them as we know you are, but we say it out loud so that we remind ourselves to be your love present too in places that need healing. God, we remember our loved ones, and we open ourselves to those that we will call beloved and yet have not met. God, may we have open hearts. God, for all that you call us to do, for those things that scare us, God, give us your strength. For those things we know how to do and hesitant, God, give us your push. And hear us now. Teach us again through these words to be your people. Eternal Spirit, Earth Maker, Pain Bearer, Life Giver, Source of all that is and that shall be, Parent of us all, Loving God, in whom is heaven. The hallowing of your name echo through the universe. The way of your justice be followed by the peoples of the world. Your heavenly will be done by all created beings. Your commonwealth of peace and freedom sustain our hope and come on earth. With the bread we need for today, feed us, In the hurts we absorb from one another, forgive us. In times of temptation and test, strengthen us. From trials too great to endure, spare us. From the grip of all that is evil, free us. For you reign in the glory of the power that is love, now and forever. Amen. And let's stand together if you're able and sing our final hymn, We Shall Overcome. There's only one verse there, so we're going to holler out the remaining verses.
We shall
to make that peace a reality today and every day. And as we do that together, God's peace is with us now and always. Amen.